The genocide of the air nomads. It's an essential part of the story in Avatar The Last Airbender, but was an event shrouded in a bit of mystery. As of this video, there's no official details on how Sozin managed to wipe out every single airbender except for Aang, but we're gonna bring up a few important questions and try our best to offer a logical conclusion to what may have happened. The first question, how exactly did they reach the air temples? I think there's like some confusion that I want to clear up in the beginning, because a lot of people, at least when I did my research, a lot of people seem to mistaken the fact that they came up with an air force and air balloons and war balloons and stuff like that after that battle in the Northern Air Temple, if you guys remember it, with the mechanic.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So they didn't have air balloons or any way to sort of just like fly over to the air temples before then. And otherwise, you know, they could have just used it to get over the walls of Ba Sing Se or something.
Yeah.
So I believe there's something said by Aang, which is really weird, because Aang says for some of the air temples, the only way to actually get there is through
the sky bison,
like having a sky bison or having airbending. So it's kind of interesting, because I feel like that's contradictory to what we've seen in the show.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you guys remember, Guru Patik was not an airbender, but he managed to get in the Eastern Air Temple. Regular Fire Nation without air balloons managed to invade the Northern Air Temple. And then we don't know too much about the Southern Air Temple, because that's where we started off seeing Monk Gyatso's dead body.
Right.
And then for the Western Air Temple, we saw that Combustion Man and Zuko also managed to get to like the main area of the Western Air Temple. So I feel like what Aang was saying is just completely incorrect, and we can't use that
Would it be possible that he was referring to specifically the Southern Air Temple?
Interesting. Maybe that might be the case.
Mm-hmm.
Which we can definitely like speculate, how did the Fire Nation army reach that area then in that case? Mm-hmm. So
because we can definitely, the Western Air Temple, like this is a thought that I've had before as well, because the Western Air Temple clearly doesn't require a Sky Bison to reach it.
Yeah.
And so it seems like there would be a discrepancy there, unless Aang, of course, was referring only to the Southern Air Temple. But then again, it's ambiguous, so we don't know for sure.
Yeah, if he was referring to all air temples, then it's definitely not the case for West, North, and East, as we've seen.
Mm-hmm.
Unless Guru Patik, I don't know, created a glider or something and somehow got up there. But but that's not the case. So if he's referring just to the Southern Air Temple, then we can speculate on how the Fire Nation managed to get there. Like, what do you guys think?
Okay, so here's my theory, right? We have to remember that when it happened, or at least from my understanding, it seemed like it happened on the comet, right? And we know that the comet does give them extraordinary powers. So, and not to mention, they also had dragons back in that time, because, you know, Sozin was on a dragon. So it's possible that they've used the dragon in the comet to use the firebending power to help them get there, and then use that to, like, you know, destroy the airbenders. So
yeah, but I'm under the impression that dragons were pretty rare. Like, the only ones we've ever seen are Avatar Roku's, Sozin's, and old Zuko's.
Yeah.
And then Ra and the Masters, basically.
Yeah, for sure. I definitely agree that they're rare, but I feel like if you have, let's just say they had 10 dragons, that and the firebending, you know, power is enough to like you can, I'm pretty sure you can have multiple people on one dragon. So it's like having that amount, and then, you know, the comet's power alone can definitely take the whole height thing, for sure. At least from my understanding.
What do you think, Osi?
Yeah, I think that theory makes sense. The fact that dragons were more available, I'm not going to say that they were like widely available, but they were more available back then. So it makes sense that the Fire Nation would have had some control over a couple of dragons at least, and they would have used that in that situation. Also, we know that firebenders are able to propel themselves. And like, that's without, like, skilled firebenders like Azula are able to do that just like normal. And so imagining that you have the Sozin's Comet and it gives a bunch of firebenders this immense power, suddenly most of the army is able to propel themselves with fire. And it depends, I suppose, on how much or how long they would have to propel themselves to reach the air temple. But if that's possible, I'm sure that that would have been, you know, a method.
That seems a little, just a little far-fetched, because we've never seen a single firebender do that, or a single normal firebender do that. We've only ever saw people like Zhang Zhang, and we didn't even see Zuko do it. So Zuko never really like propelled himself upwards or like semi-glided or flew using firebending. And he's clearly a very skilled firebender, and during the comet he never did that. So I think assuming that after all of them get that power and all of a sudden they can propel themselves is kind of just a little bit far-fetched. And in terms of the dragon helping thing, I can agree with that to some certain extent, but I don't think that it would have been enough to get like enough people to overwhelm the airbenders. Because it's not like, I mean, all we have to go off of, right, is Sozin's comment when Aang fought Ozai, right?
Yeah.
So basically Team Avatar, or half of Team Avatar, consisting of Toph, Sokka, and Suki, managed to beat a whole bunch of an air fleet worth of Fire Nation people who also had like firebenders there. And none of them showed feats that indicated that they could have like propelled themselves for like a really long time or anything like that.
Yeah, the only person I know who did that was Ozai. But
And Zhang Zhang.
Oh yeah, that's true. Zhang Zhang. I can't forget about him.
Because there's a small detail that we have to remember, is that the way that they genocided the air nomads was that they had a lot of firebenders.
Yeah.
Like a lot of people fighting against them. So it would have to have been like a massive army somehow reaching that area.
Yeah, the
and not just a couple people.
That's fair. I mean, my other theory to that is like it is possible that, you know, I mean, I don't know if they plan. See, this is the hard part, because for them to understand that they can propel, I don't know. I don't know what the plan was, but assuming that they were able to make a plan and they had a bunch of like, and they had only a few dragons, it's possible that they had firebenders that come with the dragons, that firebenders who came to the place or to the air temples, and then you had the other, and then as those firebenders go in, you also have the dragon coming down bringing more firebenders. So it's like you have this like, what's it called, kind of like a feedback loop of dragons just sending soldiers. And since they had, and since it was Sozin's comet, and I'm pretty sure, I mean, the airbenders kind of knew, but they weren't really like, they didn't really like took initiative about it. It's possible that with the firebending power, they were so overwhelmed. And then when more of them came in, it's just like, you know, it's like, I'm imagining like a giant fire coming in and you're like, okay, what do you do? And then the next giant fire comes back. So it's possible as time
goes on. That's true. That one, I can imagine that one being true. If they even had like one single dragon for each temple, being like a transportation for them to just carry people back and forth until it becomes like a lot.
Yeah. To be fair, I'm a little bit biased about this. Because, you know, I'm kind of writing a story dealing with this, so yeah. But continue.
What if we introduce another element, another potential element of it was an inside job? Meaning, what if an air nomad turned against the air against basically the rest of the air nomads and decided to, you know, secretly produce Sky Bison to the Fire Nation, probably maybe over a period of time, to the point where, like, say over 10 years, providing them a couple of baby Sky Bison every year. And then now they have an army of Sky Bison that they can use to invade.
I mean, I'm pretty sure the histories would have mentioned that, though.
Well, technically, like, in Korra, they didn't mention there was a herd of Sky Bisons during the 100-year war. So it is possible that that's how they got transportation and they had the Sky Bison hidden.
I mean, I'm pretty sure that was just a wild bunch of Sky Bison that were found after the war. But
they said during, for sure. They said during the 100-year war.
Okay, even if they said during, I don't think that they would have used them to get to the air temples, because number one, in order to actually, you know, ride a Sky Bison, you have to be sort of like bonded with it, or it has to be like
a tamed
Sky Bison.
That's true.
Like they mentioned in Korra, that a wild sky bison is very, very difficult to tame, almost impossible.
Yeah,
so,
that's fair.
Yeah, but if they train them from childhood, that's why, you know, assuming that, because if a baby sky bison goes missing, that's not going to be noticed. If a giant sky bison goes missing, that's more likely to be noticed by the air nomads. So assuming that they were released to the Fire Nation from like infanthood, the sky bisons, then it would have plenty of time for people to create bonds with them. And we know that you don't need to be an air nomad to be bonded to a sky bison. So, you know, I think that the possibility is there. I don't know. I'm having fun with the idea of betraying air nomads.
Yeah, it's a fun theory, but I do think it's kind of unlikely.
Yeah, for sure.
Because I think you do have to be an airbender, don't you?
No,
you don't.
I mean,
you don't.
We've seen in Korra that there's people who are not airbenders who are able to fly a sky bison. I mean, technically, really, even Sokka fly the sky bison in the first episode. So.
No, but they're not bonded. Like, who are you talking about in Korra?
About that to fly sky bison?
Yeah.
I mean, Asami threw a fly the sky bison before. Trying to think.
Okay. It's different if they're like the one saying yip yip, or like the one just on the sky bison and like flying them. It's different from bonding a sky bison.
Okay, bonding, that's different. But I mean, if they can fly it, that's all they need to get to the temple.
That's true. Because I believe all of us have read the Kyoshi book, right?
Some of it.
The first one, yeah.
Okay, so in minor spoiler, like when an owner of a sky bison died, the bond is severed. And the sky bison actually knows without even being there that the one they're bonded with died.
Damn.
So it's like, it's different. It's 100% different.
Mm. Okay, yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
That's true, although it is still like, it's not as if nobody else is able to use the sky bison again. And I think that's the point. Like, even if...
Yeah, that's true.
Even if there's not that same bond, the potential of riding the sky bison is still there.
Okay. I'll definitely consider your theory a possibility, but like in my mind, it's definitely an unlikely possibility.
Yeah, definitely. Because I can't see why would the air nomads betray their own people. Like that just seems a little bit
yeah.
weird.
It, also in the Kyoshi books, there is an air nomad that, you know, goes against her people. So
yeah, I know that, but that's completely different.
Precedent
though.
For that.
It's possible, but it's like,
there's a lot of, you know, life is crazy. There's a lot of crazy things.
I know life is crazy, but
there's
not enough. But yeah. Craziness needs to have some sort of, in this stories, craziness needs to have some justification. It can't just be like, whoa, we're crazy.
There's so many reasons or possibilities for one air nomad to betray the rest of them. I don't think that's crazy.
Yeah, but to kill them is a different, like, I'm pretty sure to kill them or even like,
I don't think it needs to be that deep, though. I think they just need to have somebody who's opened to be used. They don't even have to be aware fully of what their plan is. Like if somebody was just like, hey, give us a couple of sky bison, they don't know what it's going to be used for. They don't know what the plans are 10, 15 years in the future. Like that doesn't necessarily mean that this person has to be like, I want everyone I love dead. They just have to be open to be used.
To be fair to your point, like they could have definitely tricked some, like a few air nomads saying like, oh yeah, we want to just visit the air temple. And then when the air nomad with the sky bison brings like a couple Fire Nation people to the air temple, they could have set up some way for the other people to get there, like through like, I don't know, maybe rope or just setting up some ladders or a way to climb up, you know?
Right. I guess it's possible.
So I do see it being possible that they tricked the air nomads into helping them since they are like a more passive people and more peaceful people. Let's move on to like a next essential question, which is why didn't the airbenders run or like prepare if they knew something was coming? Because